غرباء 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 غرباء.
إن الحمد لله تعالى نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن نبينا وسيدنا محمدًا عبده ورسوله أرسله بالحق بين يدي الساعة بشيرًا ونذيرًا وداعيًا إلى الله بإذنه وسراجًا منيرًا، صلى الله وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليمًا كثيرًا. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله تعالى، وخير الهدى هدى محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. I want to start today's lecture by reciting to you a number of verses from the Quran, verses from Surah Fussilat, in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about those people who proclaim to believe in Allah Azza wa Jal, and then they remain steadfast upon this belief, upon this conviction, and upon this iman. And the reward that these individuals will attain towards their death, towards the end of their lives, when their souls will be taken away from this world, and the only time it will be returned to their bodies is when they stand to meet their Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah Azza wa Jal says, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم إن الذين قالوا ربنا الله ثم استقاموا تتنزل عليهم الملائكة ألا تخافوا ولا تحزنوا وأبشروا بالجنة التي كنتم توعدون نحن أولياؤكم في الحياة الدنيا وفي الآخرة ولكم فيها ما تشتهي أنفسكم ولكم فيها ما تدعون نُزُلًا مِّنْ غَفُورٍ رَّحِيمٍ. Allah Azza wa Jal speaks about these people who will find their souls resting in peace when their souls are taken away. And normally when we think about this statement, resting in peace, will you rest in peace? The first thought that comes to our mind is the thought of death, the time when our souls will be taken away from this world. This is the first thing that comes to our mind. And normally people say rest in peace, and this is what they write on gravestones, on the tombs of people. And no doubt each and every single one of us wants to rest in peace in our graves. And we want to be raised on Yawmul Qiyamah in a state of peace, a state of tranquility, a state of safety and security. We want to be from amongst those people that Allah Azza wa Jal will give glad tidings to, that Jannah is theirs, paradise, the promise of Allah is theirs. We want to be those people who will enter into Jannah without any punishment, without any accounting. We want to be from those people who, when they enter into the Jannah, the Malaika of Allah, the angels of Allah greet them and they give them salam. But the question is, how do we attain this? And what I want to focus on in this short lecture today is not what will happen when we die and the type of peace that we want to gain when we die, but the type of peace that we should be striving for in this life, that we should be striving for day in and day out, so that we can attain it in this life while we're living in our 20s and 30s and 40s and 50s and so on throughout our life. Because it is one thing to have this at the time of death, but we as Muslims also want this peace and tranquility in this life, day in, day out. So when the many trials come that we see around us, when the many hardships, difficulties and calamities befall us, we are in a state of strong iman. We feel peace and security in our hearts. We have a strong conviction and belief in Allah. We have trust in Him subhanahu wa ta'ala, certainty in the promise of Allah azza wa jal. And this allows us not only to have this peace in this life, but it allows us to taste the sweetness of Iman. It allows us to enjoy our belief in Allah, to enjoy and take pleasure from the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And how amazing is the situation of one person compared to the next. Both of them probably stand in front of Allah. Both of them will stand side by side praying to Allah Azza wa Jal. Both of them will walk side by side making tawaf around the Kaaba. Both of them will open their fast sitting together in the month of Ramadan. But one person has not yet tasted the sweetness of Iman. And because he doesn't know the sweetness of Iman, that prayer, that fasting, that tawaf, that umrah and that hajj is a burden upon him or her. It is difficult for them. And every time a trial comes and afflicts them, every time there is a calamity in their society, they feel themselves weakening. Whereas on the other hand, you have that individual next to the first, who looks in outward appearances exactly the same. But what he has in his heart, or what she has in her heart, is something which cannot be bought. It is something which you cannot apply for. It is not something which you inherit, but rather it is something which Allah Azza wa Jal grants you and bestows you with. And this is why one of the scholars of the past, one of the great people of the past known as Junaid, he would say that we see the kings in their palaces enjoying the treasures of this life. But by Allah, if they knew what we the scholars feel in our hearts, in terms of contentment, in terms of peace and security, in terms of tasting the sweetness of Iman, then they would fight us and kill us with their swords in order to gain what we have in their hearts. And so that second person also prays to Allah. They also open their fast for the sake of Allah. They also go around the Kaaba for the sake of Allah. But for them, it is an enjoyment. For them, they have tasted the sweetness of Iman. And so in this regard, I want to mention to you a beautiful hadith of our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam on the authority of Anas ibn Malik radiallahu an, a hadith collected in Al-Bukhari and Muslim, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, ثَلَاثٌ مَنْ كُنَّ فِيهِ وَجَدَ حَلَاوَةَ الْإِيمَانِ. Three things, if they are found in any individual, they will taste the sweetness of Iman. Imagine living your lives, no matter what takes place, no matter what happens with your wife or your children or your husband or your parents, no matter what happens with your business or your money, your wealth, your possessions, no matter what goes around on around you in society, what people do to you or don't do to you, none of this bothers you. Nothing makes a difference, because in your heart you have tasted the sweetness of Iman. And that sweetness of Iman is so beautiful. The taste is so sweet, it is so beautiful and pleasurable that you won't give it up for anything. Not all of the money in this world could buy what you feel. Not all of the wealth in this world could attain that pleasure and sweetness of Iman. And if someone wanted to buy it from you, you wouldn't give it to them. Because that contentment, that serenity, that peace, that security, that sweetness, it is something which is out of this world. And so the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is telling us how to attain this. If you want to taste that sweetness of Iman, and doesn't it amaze you that you find and you hear the stories of the scholars of the past, and you find people around you who will every single night wake up in the middle of the night, and they will pray for an hour or 2 hours to Allah Azza wa Jal, even though the weather is cold, even though the water they make wudu with is cold, even though they would rather sleep on their comfortable mattresses, next to their partners, on comfortable pillows, in a comfortable bed. But they give it up. Why? Because they have tasted the sweetness of Iman. People who fast in the long summer days, when fasts in this country are like 18 hours long, yet they wake up early in the morning, and they don't eat again until late at night, because they have tasted the sweetness of Iman. You go to Mecca or Medina, you go to Mecca and you perform tawaf, and people there are jostling with one another, shoving and pushing one another. One person gets hit with a wheelchair, another person is striking you on the back, someone else is pushing you left and right. And you see that individual with a smile on their face. It doesn't bother them because they have tasted the sweetness of Iman. And all they want is the pleasure of knowing their Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala. The pleasure of coming close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in that hadith al-Qudsi, that a person does not continue to come close to him subhanahu wa ta'ala until Allah azza wa jal becomes the eyes with which he sees, the ears with which he hears, the hand with which he feels and touches. Allah azza wa jal is present with that person in everything that he or she or does. And so those people are the blessed awliya of Allah. They have tasted the sweetness of Iman. ثَلَاثٌ مَنْ كُنَّ فِيهِ وَجَدَ حَلَاوَةَ الْإِيمَانِ. If you want to experience that, if you want to taste that, if you want to be able to pray like that, to perform Hajj like that, to fast like that, to give your money in charity and not care about the repercussions of poverty and bills and so on, not because you're someone who is irresponsible, but because of the sweetness that you taste when you worship your Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you want this, then this is what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentions in this hadith. And al-Imam al-Nawawi rahimahullah, he says concerning this hadith, هذا حديث عظيم من أصول الدين. This hadith is a great hadith. It is from the principles of our religion. Because our religion is not just about appearances. It is not just about the words that you say, but most importantly, it is about what is in your heart. The Iman and Taqwa of Allah that you have, the sweetness of Iman that each one of us, inshallah, is striving for, but very few of us gain and actually achieve. And so the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam says, three things will give you the sweetness of Iman. The first thing is, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, مَنْ كَانَ اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ أَحَبَّ إِلَيْهِ مِمَّا سِوَاهُمَا. That Allah and His Messenger are more beloved to you than anything besides them. That Allah and His Messenger are more beloved to you than anything else. And in another hadith in Sahih Muslim, with a very similar meaning, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, ذاق طعم الإيمان من رضي بالله ربا وبالإسلام دينا وبمحمد صلى الله عليه وسلم نبيا ورسولا. The one who has three things has tasted the sweetness of Iman. The one who is pleased with Allah as his Lord, and Islam as his religion, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam as his prophet and messenger. Such a person has tasted the sweetness of Iman. And those three things return to this hadith that we're mentioning. This hadith that we're remembering amongst ourselves. That Allah and His Messenger are more beloved to you than anything besides them. The second thing that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, مَنْ أَحَبَّ عَبْدًا لَا يُحِبُّهُ إِلَّا لِلَّهِ. That you love someone, you only love them for the sake of Allah. Loving your fellow brother and sister, not loving them except for the sake of Allah. And the third thing that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, مَنْ يَكْرَهُ أَنْ يَعُودَ فِي الْكُفْرُ بَعْدَ إِذْ أَنْقَذَهُ اللَّهُ مِنْ كَمَا يَكْرَهُ أَنْ يُلْقَى فِي النَّارُ. That you dislike that you should return to disbelief after Allah saved you from it, just as you dislike that Allah should throw you into the fire. Three things that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said. How simple they seem. How light they seem on the tongue. How easy it seems to be able to achieve it. But in reality, they are difficult tasks. They are heavy and burdensome, except for those that Allah Azza wa Jal makes it easy for. And this is why even though they seem easy on paper, they are difficult in practice. And this is why the vast majority of us are unable to achieve it. We have not yet reached this level, even though they seem simple in their nature. Let us dissect some of this, of these things that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam recommended to us. And the first thing that I want to point your attention to is this sweetness of iman. Some of the scholars said, as Ibn Hajar rahimahullah mentions in Al-Fath al-Bari, that the scholars mention that Allah Azza wa Jal describes iman as being sweet, because the essence of iman is described in the Quran as being a tree. The essence of iman is la ilaha illallah, to worship none except Allah Azza wa Jal, to know that none has the right to be worshipped except Allah. And Allah Azza wa Jal describes this statement in the Quran, describes this word in the Quran as being like a tree. أَلَمْ تَرَ كَيْفَ ضَرَبَ اللَّهُ مَثَلًا كَلِمَةً طَيِّبَةً كَشَجَرَةٍ طَيِّبَةً أَصْلُهَا ثَابِتٌ وَفَرْعُهَا فِي السَّمَاءِ. Do you not see the parable that Allah Azza wa Jal places before you of the goodly word, of the good statement? Its example is like the good tree. Its roots are firm and its branches reach up into the heavens, up into the skies. This word, this good statement, this good word, it is a statement of La ilaha illallah. There is not a single statement which is better than this statement. Not a single statement better than your attestation that none has the right to be worshipped except Allah Azza wa Jal alone. And so the scholars say, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam described iman as being sweet, because Allah describes the origin of iman, the essence of iman in the Quran, to be like a tree. And like every tree, it has fruit. And this fruit can sometimes be ripe. It can sometimes be moldy because it is too old. It can sometimes be unripe. But if the tree is perfect, if the tree and its seed are good, and the way that it was watered is good, and it has enough sunshine, and if enough water, then it will rise and it will give off good fruit. And this fruit, if it is picked in its proper time, and it is eaten in its proper time, then it will be sweet. You will taste the sweetness of this fruit. And so inshallah, most of us have this iman. We have this tree, but because we're not watering it properly, because it doesn't have enough exposure to the sun, because of one element or another, we don't get the fruit that we want. The fruit that we're tasting isn't sweet. It's bitter, or it's unripe, or there's something wrong with it. It's because one of these components is not there. So the scholars said that Allah Azza wa Jal mentions the goodly word as being the statement of La ilaha illallah. And this tree, it is the tree of iman. And its branches are that you do that which Allah and His Messenger ordered sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and you stay away from that which Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam prohibited. And they say that its leaves are everything which you do of good. Any good act which you do, then there is a leaf upon this tree. And such a tree will give off fruit, and its fruit will be sweet to taste. And this is why we want this sweetness of iman. Imagine having a tree like that, that would be with you constantly, 365 days a year, day and night, whether it was winter or summer, spring or autumn, whether you're traveling or you're stationary, whether you're ill or you're healthy, your own personal tree, that you can take the fruit off whenever you want and eat it whenever you want, and it would taste in a way that you have never been able to taste anything else. Imagine having this pleasure. And this is the parable, this is the example of having that sweetness of iman, to be constantly worshipping Allah Azza wa Jal in a way that you enjoy and take pleasure and sustenance from this worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when you understand this concept, then you understand when you read the stories of the companions radiallahu anhum, the stories of the great scholars of Islam, and how they used to constantly worship Allah, remembering Allah thousands of times a day, praying all night, standing all night in prayer, fasting for the whole day, giving their wealth away in charity as if it was just dirt or something. You understand this concept once you understand how beautiful iman can taste. But like we said, it is a struggle and a strive in order to be able to reach this level. It is a struggle and a strive. And so the first thing that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam mentioned is that you love Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and nothing is more beloved to you than them. And you see this so many times. in the lives of the companions radiyallahu anhum, in the lives of the great scholars of Islam. Even the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam mentioned this so many times. And we all know the famous hadiths that none of you truly believes until I am more beloved to him than his family and his children, his parents and everyone else. You know the famous story of Umar radiyallahu anhu when he came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and he said, O Messenger of Allah, you are more beloved to me than everything else except myself. And then the Prophet ﷺ said, not yet Umar, you haven't perfected Iman yet. And then he came back and he said, O Messenger of Allah, you are more beloved to me than my own self. And the Prophet ﷺ said, now O Umar. These are hadith that we know. These are famous statements that all of us are familiar with. But we see it also in the example of the companions radiyallahu anhum. And again, these are stories which are well known to each and every single one of us. The story of that woman in the Battle of Uhud, when the people came to her and they told her that her son had died, and her father had died, and her husband had died. And each time she's asking, what about the Prophet of Allah? What about the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam? She's not concerned about her father, her brother, her husband. She wants to know what happened with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, loving Allah and his Messenger more than anything else. And so when they tell her that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is safe, he is alive, he is healthy, she says, "Kullu musibatin ba'dahu jalal." Any calamity after him is nothing. It is irrelevant. The greatest calamity that could befall is a calamity which befalls to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And it wasn't only in their love for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, but this was translated into action. It was action which they performed. When the order came, when a prohibition came from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, this is where we see the example of the companions. Because let's face it, many of us profess to have this type of love, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is more beloved to us than anything else. But as soon as something comes from the Quran and Sunnah, then we have to think twice. Then we have to observe and analyze. Look at the pros and cons. Because our love isn't at that level yet. Whereas you have the likes of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, a man who tasted the sweetness of Iman, a man who loved Allah and his Messenger more than anyone else and anything else. When his servant comes to him and he gives him some food, and each day Abu Bakr would ask him, where did you get this food from? Where did you get this food from? Because he wanted to ensure that it was halal. So that day he comes and Abu Bakr forgets to ask. And so he begins to eat the food. And then he remembers and he says, where did the food come from? And the servant says, before Islam, in the days of Jahiliyyah, before Islam, I used to be a fortune teller. And so I told someone's fortune. And many years later it has come to pass. It is now taken shape. And so that man came and he gave me some money because it was my right, because he gave it to me as a reward for telling him his future. And I took that money and I bought this food from you. And so Abu Bakr radiallahu anh sticks his finger into his throat and he begins to vomit out everything which he had just eaten. So the people say, why are you doing this? You didn't know what took place. What you had eaten had already entered into your stomach. Why do you want to vomit it out? And so he says, by Allah, if it meant that my soul left my body, I would continue to do so. Because I heard the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam say that any body which is nurtured upon haram, then the fire of hell has more right to it. فَالنَّارُ أَوْلَى بِهِ. The fire of hell has more right to it. And even though it was a mistake, even though he did it out of ignorance, his love of Allah and his Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam did not allow him to fathom the idea that something haram was in his body, that it would remain in his body, and in that state he would have to go and worship his Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is tasting the sweetness of Iman. So how do we achieve this love for Allah and his Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam? Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah, he mentions a number of things that we can do. And all of them are practical things that each and every single person has the capability of doing. And this is one of the most beautiful things about our religion. To taste the sweetness of Iman, you don't need a PhD in Islamic studies. You don't need to be a wealthy individual. You don't need to be someone who is known to be pious and righteous. You can all do it. Every single person has the ability to attain this level of tasting the sweetness of Iman. And so Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah, he mentions a number of things. Number one, that you recite the Quran and you understand its meanings and you ponder over them. Which person isn't able to do this? To frequently recite the Quran, but not only to recite it, to understand it and to ponder over its meanings. It is something which each and every single person is able to attain. The second thing, that you come closer to Allah with optional acts, with recommended acts, not with obligatory acts, because that is something which each and every single person must do. You don't have a choice. But to taste the sweetness of Iman, you need to increase on this. You need to worship Allah by standing the night in prayer, by giving extra charity, by fasting outside the month of Ramadan, by performing Umrah over and over again, and doing all of these optional acts. So you come closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The third thing is that you constantly remember Allah. You're in a constant state of remembrance of Allah Azza wa Jal. Your tongue, your heart, your limbs are constantly in a state of remembrance of Allah Azza wa Jal. You are constantly conscious and aware of Allah Azza wa Jal. And that you know that He is always watching you, that He hears you, that He sees you, that He knows everything that you do, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number four, that you place the love of Allah above your own desires. So when your desires clash with the commandment from Allah Azza wa Jal, then you would give preference to the commandment of Allah over your own desires. Because you love Allah more than your own desires. And when you reach this level, where when your own soul, when your own devil that's within you that whispers to you, when they're commanding you to follow your desires, to disobey Allah, but you know in your heart that what you are doing is wrong. You know that Allah has forbidden this, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has forbidden this. Then you give preference to Allah and His Messenger over yourself and your own desires. Number five, he says, that you come to know the names and attributes of Allah, and that you ponder over them. Because when you know that Allah Azza wa Jal is all hearing and all seeing and all knowing, and that He knows the unseen, then this will drive you to not sin against Allah. It will take you away from disobeying Allah Azza wa Jal. When you know that He is someone who is severe in punishment, someone whose punishment is severe, then it will scare you from disobeying Allah. And when you do trip up, and when you do sin, and when you do disobey Allah because of a weakness from you, then you know that He is of forgiving, most merciful. And so you return to Him and you make tawbah to Him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number six, he says, to look around you, to look at the many blessings that Allah has bestowed upon you and the blessings that Allah has bestowed around you, to know them and to recognize and acknowledge them. The many blessings that Allah Azza wa Jal has given you. Number seven, that you show humility in front of Allah Azza wa Jal. So that when you pray, when you worship Him, when you fast, when you stand in front of Him subhanahu wa ta'ala, you do it not with a sense of arrogance and pride, as if you are doing a favor to Allah, but you do it with humility. You do it with humbleness, knowing that Allah Azza wa Jal is the one who deserves to be worshipped. And that even though you are worshipping Allah and performing this deed, there is no guarantee that Allah will accept it. And so you show this humility and humbleness to Allah Azza wa Jal. Number eight, he says, that you spend the night in seclusion with your Lord. That you stand up during the night whilst others are sleeping. That is a time when you are alone with Allah, when everyone around you is asleep. And that time when you cannot show off, when you cannot show others what you are doing, and no one knows that you're praying to Allah except you and Allah, that is the time that you make dua to Allah, that you ask for the mercy of Allah. And when you reach that level, as you hear from the scholars, that they would every night make sure that they would pray to Allah. Never would they miss a night, whether traveling or whether they were stationary. They would always worship Allah Azza wa Jal during the night, even if it was just for a short period. You understand, because there is a sweetness to this type of worship. And number nine, he says, that you sit with the righteous and the pious, that you keep the company of the righteous and the pious, those who will remind you of Allah, those who will encourage you to remember Allah, to worship Allah, to come closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Other scholars have mentioned signs of loving the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and the signs that show that we have come closer to loving the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. The first one is that we feel a sadness and remorse that we weren't able to meet our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, that we didn't see him in this life. But at the same time, we know and we have this knowledge and this certainty that if inshallah we enter into Jannah, then we will see our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And on Yawmul Qiyamah, with our Iman, we will be raised under his flag sallallahu alayhi wasallam, that we are from his Ummah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Thawban, one of the servants of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he once came to him sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and his color had changed, his facial features had changed, his situation looked different. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said to him, "What's wrong with you? What's wrong with you? Why do you look so different?" And so he said, "O Messenger of Allah, I don't have any illness or pain, but I love to come and sit in your company. And when I leave you, I feel a loneliness which does not leave me until I come back to you, O Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. But then I remember the akhirah, the hereafter, that a time will come that you will die and I will die and we will be separated. And then I think about Jannah, and that when we enter into Jannah, you will have the highest stations in Jannah. You will be with the greatest of people in Jannah. And as for me, then I will be in a lower station if I enter into Jannah." And look at this humility and humbleness. If I enter into Jannah, then I will be in a low station. You will be in a much higher station. And then we will never be able to meet again. And this is where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the verse, وَمَنْ يُطِعِ اللَّهَ وَالرَّسُولِ فَأُولَٰئِكَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ مِنَ النَّبِيِّينَ وَالصِّدِّيقِينَ وَالشُّهَدَاءِ وَالصَّالِحِينَ وَحَسُنَ أُولَٰئِكَ رَفِيقًا. Those who obey Allah and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, then those will be with those that Allah azza, they will be with those that Allah has blessed, from the prophets and from the right, the truthful and the righteous and the martyrs. And what a blessed companionship there is. So Allah azza wa jal is teaching him and us that if you truly believe in Allah and you obey Allah and his Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and you love them more than anything else, then you too will be resurrected with him sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and inshallah in Jannah you will be with him as well. And so this is one of the things that shows our love for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, our yearning and longing to meet him sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Something else which shows this and is connected to the first is that then if we have this yearning and this longing to meet our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, then we obey his commandments, we refrain from his prohibitions, we follow his sunnah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, because this is what true love means. True love isn't just that you pick and choose what suits you, that you follow the sunnah when it's convenient for you, but that you love Allah and his messenger more than anything else. And number three, that you protect him, that you defend him, that you defend his sunnah, that you defend his religion. And if he were alive, then it would mean defending him in person, but after his death sallallahu alayhi wasallam, to defend his teachings and his sunnah. And we all know the example of that companion who, when he was captured by the non-Muslims and he was being punished, they said to him, "Would you not wish that Muhammad was in your place? That you were sitting at home with your family in luxury and comfort and peace, and that Muhammad was in your place being tortured and persecuted and harmed?" And so he said, "No, by Allah, no, by Allah, I would not want that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam would even be harmed by a thorn, and I was sitting at home with my family." This is love of Allah and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And this is why Al-Imam Ibn Rajab rahimahullah, he mentions that love is of two types: a love which is obligatory, and a love which is recommended and something which we should all strive for. As for the obligatory love, then it is a part of our iman that we believe in the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that we love the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that we follow his commandments and we believe in his truthfulness and his message and so on. But there is a second type of love, a love that you strive for. And that is that you try to emulate his character sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that you eat the way he ate, that you drink the way he drank, that you walk the way he walked, that you interact with others the way he would interact with people sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And when you are a living, walking, breathing example of the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then this is a sign that you love Allah and his messenger more than anything else. Time does not permit us to go into a lengthy discussion, but this in and of itself could be a lecture on its own. The second thing that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, that you love your brother and you don't love him except for the sake of Allah. Loving your fellow Muslim, something so simple, yet something which many of us have lost. To love an individual only for the sake of Allah, not because they're related, not because they happen to grow up with you, not because they have money or status, but rather for the sake of Allah and Allah alone. And there are many ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that speak about this, and all of us know this. In Sahih Muslim, Allah Azza wa Jal will say on Yawm al-Qiyamah, who are those who love one another for my sake? Where are they? Where are those people who love one another for my sake? And then Allah Azza wa Jal will say to them, today you will have my shade. And we know from the other hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that they will be from amongst those people, those seven people who will be granted the shade of Allah. Those two people who love each other for the sake of Allah, they meet on this love and they depart upon this love. In Sahih Muslim, in another hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned that story of a man who set out, who traveled for the sake of meeting his brother for Allah's sake. Meeting his brother in Islam, in religion, for the sake of Allah alone. And so Allah Azza wa Jal sent to him an angel in the form of a man. And the angel came to him and he said, where are you going? And so he replied, I am going to meet my fellow brother. And then the angel asked, why do you go? Do you have some need? Is there some reason that you're going? Is there some worldly reason that you approach him? And he replied, no, except that I love him for the sake of Allah. And then the angel replied that, no, that I am a messenger from your Lord. And I have been commanded to tell you that just as you love him for the sake of Allah, that Allah Azza wa Jal also loves you. And so this is that status, loving one another for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it doesn't just mean that it's something which we profess on our tongues, but rather it's something which we believe and we act upon. So that when your brother has a need, you race and hasten towards that need of your brother. It is reported that one of the Salaf, he had debt upon him. And his closest friend had debt upon him. And so when one of them had enough money, he went to pay off the debt of his brother. And the other one, when he had enough money, he went to pay off the debt of the first. Both of them not knowing what the other was doing. But both of them wanting to go and fulfill the needs of his fellow brother. It means that you don't speak ill of your friend, of this person that you love for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that you're not jealous of them, that you possess no hatred or enmity towards them, but rather you make dua for them, that you wish good for them, that when you're alone in your prayer, you ask Allah Azza wa Jal and you make dua for your brother, that you show sincerity towards him, that you show goodness towards him in everything that you can do. And the third and final thing, and we'll conclude with this, is the last thing which the Prophet ﷺ mentioned, that you dislike that you should return to disbelief after Allah saved you, just as you dislike to be thrown into the fire. My dear brothers and sisters, Allah Azza wa Jal has given us the greatest blessing that He can give to anyone. And that is the blessing of this religion, that Allah is your Lord, and that you recognize and acknowledge that Allah is alone. And He alone has the right to be worshipped. And you live your lives as Muslims who worship Allah alone. This is one of the greatest blessings that Allah can give to anyone. To acknowledge and recognize the blessing of Islam. and to know the rewards associated with following this path and remaining steadfast upon this path. So then why would you want to change and exchange this for something which is far less? To be thrown into the fire, to be those that Allah Azza wa Jal curses and that He is angry with, subhanahu wa ta'ala, that you dislike to return to that state just as you dislike to be thrown into the fire. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us and enable us and allow us to taste the sweetness of Iman. May He make us from amongst those who love Allah and His Messenger and love nothing more than our love for Allah and His Messenger. May He make us from amongst those who love our brothers and sisters purely and sincerely for His sake, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And may He make us steadfast upon our religion. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم ولجميع المسلمين من كل ذنب فاستغفروه إنه هو الغفور الرحيم.
غرباء غرباء.